Hello, my name is Dr. Alison Volpe Holmes. I'm an associate professor of pediatrics, and I'm an attending pediatrician in our newborn nursery. I'm here to talk with you today about our innovative work at Dartmouth-Hitchcock in caring for the newborn patients during the opioid epidemic. So I'm a general pediatrician by training with a special interest in clinical quality improvement in the newborn nursery. The littlest victims of our opioid epidemic here at Dartmouth-Hitchcock suffer from opioid withdrawal after they're born. So when mothers are pregnant, they are taking medications of any type, either through active abuse of opioids or they're as prescribed on a maintenance medication like methadone for a healthy pregnancy. But when their babies are born, they suffer withdrawal symptoms from this work. 1 in 10 newborns born here at our medical center is exposed to opioids before delivery. I first actually worked with babies withdrawing from opioids 25 years ago when I lived in Seattle before medical school. And when I finished work at one end of the medical center, I would walk down to the other end of the medical center to the neonatal ICU, and I would hold babies who were mostly withdrawing from heroin there at that time and help to do anything to lessen their withdrawal. So I came here on faculty in 2006, and I was immediately struck by the numbers of babies that were exposed to opioid medications during pregnancy. It was very, very different from where I'd come from in New York State. And this is, of course, many years before the opioid epidemic had hit the news. So we started really working on this problem quite a bit before anybody else started working on the problem. When babies are exposed in pregnancy, they're getting a steady stream of opioids, and then after birth, they are removed from that steady stream of opioids. And they withdraw just like any other person would if they were constantly physically dependent on opioid medications. Withdrawal is very uncomfortable for babies, as it is for adult patients, but it looks a little bit different. And what I often say is the babies can't do their regular baby things. They can't eat well, they can't sleep, and they cry a lot, and it's very hard to console them. They sweat, they sneeze, they can scream sometimes and have a very difficult time with it. So traditionally what we do for babies, or what's been traditionally done for a long time, is that babies with withdrawal would be placed in a neonatal intensive care unit. They would be in a bassinet like this one. These units are full of babies in bassinets or in incubators, and parents are not typically there. The treatment course would go on for weeks or even months without a lot of parent presence with the babies. They'd be placed on a nursery ICU type of schedule where they need to eat on a certain schedule. They're placed on a monitor. They're given medication on a certain schedule. And they're kind of left open in the crib. So what we did in our model here to do something different, because by the time we got to about 2012, our neonatal ICU couldn't handle the numbers of babies that we had anymore, and we just had to do something different so we could take care of the other babies in the region that really needed intensive care. So we looked at some things that had been published from other small centers that said that babies staying with their parents did better and maybe didn't need as much medication and didn't stay in the hospital as much. So as you can imagine, if instead of out in an open crib, this baby can be wrapped up in a blanket. It can be calmed just the way any other baby would like to be swaddled. It doesn't have to be in the bright lights as it is out in the intensive care unit. It can be in a dark room. It can be held by a parent or another family member. And so we decided to try this kind of model. So we have the parents and the babies together caring for their children in a rooming in model. It's called rooming in. So we went from the standard neonatal ICU care to full rooming in care very quickly here over the course of about a year. And we had pretty dramatic results. So we found that we cut in half the use of medications for the babies, we cut in half the length of stay, and we also more than halved the costs of care. We studied our innovative approach and we published it in one of our top journals, and it got attention not only from the medical press but also from the popular media, because this had at that time become such a big problem in so many places. In 2015, we won a National Quality Innovation Award for this work. In following up on this, we wanted to see if we could look at bigger numbers. And so my team worked with a group at the Dartmouth Institute that did a special analysis looking at our work and combined it with all the other studies out there on rooming in. And earlier this year, we published a much bigger paper that again got a lot of attention, showing that in a rooming in model, you actually cut the length of stay by close to 2 weeks. You cut the use of medication by 2/3, and again, cut the costs by more than half. So at this point, there are a lot of other centers very interested in this model, because by now the epidemic has spread to so many other parts of the country. It hit us very early and it hit us very hard, somewhat forcing us to be innovative in how we did things. But now this model of rooming in is known as the Dartmouth model. And so people want to learn to do what we did here and how they can replicate our successes at their centers. So fortunately, our work has been picked up by the American Academy of Pediatrics. And what they would like us to do is to help lead something like a 30 hospital improvement collaborative, where we help other large academic centers transition from the traditional neonatal ICU model of care to this new model of rooming in care. What we need, though, is to bring some funding to that project team, because they have various competing projects that they have coming towards them to use this network. So they can give you a priority score, but you also need to show that you can bring in some external funding for that work. I do think that our team here at Dartmouth Kitchcock is the right one to do this work, because we've already had a lot of success in this area. We've published 2 really high impact, widely cited publications for this and could do so again with the bigger work. And 3, we already have people coming to us to ask for our expertise for this. So we seem like the right people to lead the project. Funding that comes in through philanthropy and donations to our work to take care of opioid withdrawal in our newborn population would certainly have a multiplier effect, because we already have the backing of this potential project from the American Academy of Pediatrics. So with approximately 3 years of funding, about $200,000 a year, we could get our innovative work off the ground and spread across the country very quickly.
Thank you, Alison, very much. It was very helpful to learn more about your project and what you're working on, amazingly innovative work. A question that I have that comes to mind is, what are the long-term effects that children have after the rooming in process is concluded? You know, can you see some positive results going forward on how babies and their parents, after they go through this process, are actually progressing?
It's a really terrific question. We know exceedingly little about how opioid exposure during pregnancy affects babies long-term. We can't even really know about it overall, let alone if they had different types of treatment in the early newborn period, if either of those make a difference. My group is actually starting to see if we can look back at some of our data from the last few years to get an answer to that question. So we have a senior year academic scholar student from the Geisel School of Medicine who's applying in pediatrics. She's taking an extra year and working with our team and working with my colleague, Dr. Nina Sand-Loud, who's our development behavior pediatrician. Since we already have data on about 600 babies since 2012, we are gonna go back and do a retrospective review to see if we can see if there's any difference between the babies getting their care in the neonatal ICU versus those that roomed in with their parents, and also to see if the babies, the special subset that would have gotten medication in the neonatal ICU that now don't because they're with their parents, if we can see if there's anything particular about that group when they come in for their 18-month, their 2-year visits, because we do standard developmental assessments at those visits. So we are already looking at that.
Great, thank you.
That's great. Thank you so much. This was a terrific presentation, and it's really impressive work. And it's so important, and it's great that news that you'll be spreading this across the country. So you mentioned that you're asking for $200,000 a year for the project team for the next 3 years. What do you see as a future state after that, 5 to 10 years? Like, what is your hope that this would do even further down the road?
So my hope is that the standard of care for opioid-exposed newborns would be rooming in. I think people realize, especially after our second paper, that the evidence is solid, and what needs to happen now is what we call implementation. And so one of the reasons being here, working with the folks at the Dartmouth Institute, is we have some excellent implementation science experts that my team would be able to collaborate with to really study how to implement this so that we can really be giving the best care to babies across the country, because our opioid epidemic probably is going to take a decade or two to subside. So it's very important that we get this as right as we can now, because these babies are going to be in our schools in 5 years, and anything that we can do to figure out what the right things to do are early would be very helpful. So part of the idea of using that funding in an implementation of rooming in would be to get some more of that research data too, so you can embed some research questions to figure out which part of what you're implementing in a rooming in model really makes the best difference for the longer term outcomes.
Well, that's terrific. Thank you so much for your time today. This was really an impressive presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.